To start out with, I don't actually believe in conceptual engineering. Thanks for inviting me to your conceptual engineering seminar. And what I'm going to talk about today is a little bit about why I don't. What I'm really going to do, though, is defend a kind of conditional conclusion that if you accept a certain kind of metasemantic view, then you shouldn't believe in conceptual engineering. And I'm not, I'll give you a little bit of a hint as to why you might want to accept the antecedent of that conditional as well, but I won't defend the antecedent in detail. So here's what I'm going to try to do. I'm going to start out by talking about an argument from Herman Cappelen, which he calls the master argument for conceptual engineering. I start out with this because I do think it makes kind of a plausible case for the possibility of conceptual engineering. But what I want to do is show that the argument doesn't work on certain popular kinds of metasemantic views, and then bring out the features of those views that make it the case that conceptual engineering isn't possible if those views are true. Then, if there's time after that, I will talk a bit about my own preferred metasemantic view, which shares some of the relevant features. But one of the things that I want to talk about is some of the ways that it might be modified, or that you might, some of the choice points for views like that, that might make a sort of crack of room for conceptual engineering, even given the kind of metasemantics that, that I want to defend. Okay. So here's the master argument. I've quoted this, and evidently I didn't include the citation, but this is from a paper that is in this recent Conceptual Ethics and Conceptual Engineering collection. I think this argument is closely related to what Cappelen calls the prudential argument in the book Fixing Language. And so I think the kind of objections I'm raising here would also go for the prudential argument, if you're familiar with that. But here's how he puts it in the paper. If W is a word that has meaning M, then there are many similar meanings, M1, M2, MN, that W could have had. We have no good reason to think that the meaning that W ended up with is the best meaning W could have. There will typically be I need to shrink this so I can see the screen, right? There will typically be indefinitely many alternative meanings that would be better meanings for W. When we speak, think, and theorize, it's important to make sure our words have as good meanings as possible. As a corollary, when doing philosophy, we should try to find good meanings for core philosophical terms, and they will typically not be the meanings that those words, as a matter of fact, have. So no matter what a topic a philosopher is concerned with, she should assess and ameliorate the meanings of central terms. Okay, so just to preview, I think premise one is true. There are lots of possible meanings out there. I think there's a way of understanding premise two on which it's also true. In general, we should think that it's at least possible that in some sense, the meaning that W ended up with isn't the meaning that W could have. We need to be a little bit careful here, especially when we come to my preferred temporal externalist metasemantics, but I'm not gonna press too hard on two. I think something in the ballpark of two is gonna be right. But where I think the argument goes wrong is in premise three. And I'm going to explain exactly why in just a second. In considering I'm going to focus on premise three. I think it'll be clear how, once we see what I think is wrong with premise three, well, what's wrong with four and five. So I'm not going to, when I represent this argument, I'm not going to include the conclusion. I'm only going to include the premises so we can see where premise three goes wrong. But feel free to ask me later if you're worried about what you should think about four and five after that has all come. Okay, so why do I think premise three is a problem? Well, I think we need to be careful about what we're trying to show here. So there's some things in the ballpark here that everyone should agree with. For example, everyone agrees that we evaluate and revise our views of how things are, our theories in a very broad sense, where this would include what we believe, what we know, the sentences we accept. If we bear some attitude towards our best theories that's weaker than belief, as some anti-realists about science think, the things we bear that attitude towards too, and so on. So we evaluate and revise our commitments, our theories in this sense. In familiar kinds of ways, we consider and weigh evidence. We might wonder whether a certain claim is true. And when we do that, we think about the evidence for it. We might think out how we can get new evidence that will bear for or against it. If we decide that the evidence tells against the theory we have now, we'll try to formulate new theories, so on. These are all familiar things, uncontroversial. Everyone agrees that we do them. What's slightly more controversial is that we evaluate our views on various practical and normative grounds. So we might compare different theories with respect to things like simplicity. Arguably, at least, that is a kind of pragmatic feature. Nonetheless, it does seem to play a role in theory choice in science and in other kinds of disciplines. Slightly more controversially still, we might consider the normative, ethical, practical, etc. consequences of our theories. If we think a theory is morally bad in some way, we think a theory is racist, for example, that might be a reason to give it up. Again, like, there are going to be controversies about particular details of how this works, but I think most people are going to agree that in some cases, in some sense or other, we evaluate views on these kind of practical and normative grounds. Now, there are lots of issues in working out the details, but I'm going to take it that we have a kind of working grasp of these uncontroversial ways we engage with our views and our theories. We're going to disagree about some particular cases. We're going to disagree about the correct theoretical description of some of these things, but it's uncontroversial that we do things like this a lot of the time. Now, I take it that this master argument is not supposed to just be in the business of defending a claim that everyone already accepts. The idea that we evaluate our theories in light of evidence isn't really a claim that is in need of defense. So publishing a paper with a master argument can't be intended to defend it. When we're defending conceptual engineering, when Cappelen's defending conceptual engineering, he must be trying to defend a claim that he thinks somebody is going to reject, or at least a claim that he doesn't think everybody knew already, that somebody's gonna sort of find surprising or controversial. So when we look at the conclusions of this argument, when we look at premise three of this argument, and when Cappelen's saying things like, we need to make sure our words have as good meanings as possible, we need to try to find good meanings, he's got to be suggesting some kind of novel activity, something over and above just these kinds of familiar ways of assessing our theories, our views, our beliefs, and so on. So it's not just assessing these things in light of evidence, and it's not even assessing these things in light of the kind of pragmatic and normative factors that I mentioned. It's got to be something different than that. So I think that anyone who is advancing an argument like Cappelen's argument here is committed to a distinctness claim. That is to say, conceptual engineering, the process of assessing concept and word meanings, that's Cappelen says assessing and improving concepts and word meanings, it's got to be something different from mere theorizing of the sort that I described in the previous slides. It may involve seeking out and weighing evidence. It may involve these familiar kinds of normative evaluation of beliefs and theories, but it's got to include something more than that. Otherwise, it's not really worth defending. Again, it's something that we all accepted already. Okay, so with that in mind, I suggest that premise 3 of this master argument has to be understood in something like the following way. When we speak, think, and theorize, there's an additional activity, something over and above theorizing and the familiar kinds of speaking and thinking that contribute to theorizing, that is over and above this kind of weighing of evidence and so on, that it's important to engage in. We have to make sure our words have as good meanings as possible. Okay, so that's the understanding of 3 that I'm going to reject. I just don't think there is any such additional activity. And in order to defend that view, my strategy is going to be to consider a kind of familiar metasemantic story and to show that given that metasemantic story, there is no such additional over and above kind of activity. Then I'm going to try and discuss the features of that metasemantic story that produce that consequence. So the familiar story is the Ramsey, Carnap, Lewis, how to define theoretical terms, metasemantics. So Lewis put this forward following on well-known work by Ramsey and Carnap as a way of describing how the terms that are introduced by a theory get the meanings that they have. So I think the easiest way to see it is to look at a kind of toy theory. So here's my toy theory. I took this from a Star Wars wiki. So apologies for that, and apologies to any original trilogy purists who object to this midi-chlorians business. I have some sympathy with that, actually, but so here's the theory. Midi-chlorians are a species of sentient and microscopic organisms that inhabit the cells of every life form. The force is an all-encompassing energy field, and midi-chlorians create the force. Okay, so just to understand how Lewis intended the scope of this theory, it's only meant to be a story about how the theoretical terms, that is to say, the terms introduced by this theory at a particular, the terms introduced by this theory get their meaning. So we'll take for granted species, sentient, microscopic, and so on. What we want a story about is how midichlorians and the force get their meaning. So let's suppose those are terms that are kind of unique to this theory. According to Lewis, they get their meaning from the theory. It's in virtue of being a part of this theory, advanced as a part of this theory, that they get the meaning that they have. And what he's going to show you is how you can kind of describe that meaning, describe what he takes the meaning to be on the basis of this theory. Okay. I think the simplest way to see this is in 3 steps. So first of all, you just take out all of the theoretical terms and replace them with variables. So you can see here, I've just replaced every instance of midichlorians with x1 and every instance of the force with x2. So now at step one, we already have a kind of open sentence that's captures some of what the theory was saying, that looks a bit like the theory. And now in step 2, we existentially bind those variables. So step 2 says there's a unique x1 and a unique x2 such that x1 are a species of sentient and microscopic organisms that inhabit the cells of every life form, and x2 is an all-encompassing energy field, and x1 creates x2. Okay, so now we have a sentence which comes pretty close to capturing the content of the theory that we started out with, but doesn't contain the problematic theoretical terms. And we can use that sentence, we can to give an explicit definition of the theoretical terms. We just, in effect, have to say which of those variables they correspond to. So step three says the force is the unique x2 such that there's a unique x1 such that, et cetera, et cetera. Or if nothing uniquely satisfies the description, then the force denotes nothing. Okay, so you see what we've done here. On the right-hand side, there's none of these theoretical terms. It's all old familiar terms and logical apparatus, but we've used that to define this theoretical term, the force, and likewise we can define midichlorians, but I won't do that for you. Now, just to stress again, this can look like we're kind of giving an explicit definition here, but I think as Lewis is intending this, this is a way of describing the meanings that these expressions already had. So it's not as though we have to go through these three steps to give the expression the force its meaning. The force, in virtue of being a theoretical term, a part of the theory that it is a part of, it already had that meaning. And this apparatus is just giving us a way of describing the meaning that it had. Okay. So suppose that's all right. Now, if that's right, one might have thought that theoretical terms are kind of ripe for conceptual engineering. And that's just because these theoretical matters seem like matters that should be up for debate. But it looks like if this Ramsey Carnap Lewis story is right, there's a sense in which they're not. Because it's true by definition here that the force is, if it exists, is all pervasive. That just follows from the definition we've given in step three. But suppose I want to say, well, the force exists all right, but it's merely widespread, not all pervasive. That seems like it might, that doesn't seem like a kind of analytic falsehood or something like that. It feels like a claim that we might want to advance in the course of theorizing, but given the Ramsey Carnap Lewis story, it's ruled out by definition. So in order to say that, if I want to say that, I have to adopt a new definition. So I'll have to replace the definition of the force that I gave on the previous slide with something like this one. The force is the unique X2 such that there's a unique X1 such that blah, blah, blah. And X2 is a widespread energy field. Okay, so this kind of change in theory is going to come with, or in order to make it, we'll have to adopt a new definition. And you might have thought, well, this is exactly the kind of thing that the conceptual engineer is gonna love, because we've got this kind of analytic, definitional, conceptual falsehood, and we've got to get rid of it. And the way to do that is get rid of the old meanings, the old concepts we had, and come up with new ones. And so that's in a way exactly what Ramsey Carnap Lewis is predicting. Okay. But I don't think that's right. So that's just because, think about what this view is saying. The view is saying that the meaning of these theoretical terms comes from the theory in which they're embedded. And that just means in order to change the definition, we have to change the theory. So adopting the definition that I gave on the previous slide, we can sort of backtrack through those three steps in a way. That's just to adopt this new theory. Instead of, we've replaced theory one with theory two that says midichlorians are a species of sentient and microscopic organisms that inhabit the cells of every life form. the force is a widespread energy field instead of an all-pervasive energy field. Midichlorians create the force. Okay, so what we've come down to now is a dispute between proponents of two theories, or a dispute between ourselves and trying to think through which theory to adopt. We might try to assess the merits of one theory versus another, but this is going to be a matter of these familiar kind of theoretical activities that I sketched in an earlier slide. Things like assessing evidence, assessing which theory is simpler, which might have better normative consequences, and so on. So, well, it's true that changing theories according to this view will bring with it changes in definition. It's not as though there is this additional, over and above, distinct activity of conceptual engineering. No, all there is the theoretical activity. There's really nothing else to do on this kind of view, no sort of further thing other than get your beliefs, get your theory straight. And so I think this violates distinctness. If the Ramsey-Carnap-Lewis theory is true, the only thing that there is to do is consider which theory to adopt. Once we get the theory right, the meanings will take care of themselves. But what somebody like Cappelen needs is for there to be this other thing that we have to do, this conceptual engineering, a distinct activity. And I think given the Ramsey-Carnap-Lewis story, there just isn't. Okay, so let's try to be a little bit more precise here. What exactly is the problem? Well, one thing that Cappelen spends a lot of time worrying about is control over meaning. So he anticipates a kind of objection to his view. He's a kind of super externalist who thinks that external factors that we don't even understand really fix what we mean in ways we don't understand. And it's really not up to us what we mean at all. And he imagines somebody might say, well, look, how can you be a conceptual engineer then? Because don't you have to have some kind of control over what you mean in order to engineer it? And he says, no. He says some things that I don't find super persuasive, but one thing that I think is right, is kind of a good point in response to that objection, is we theorize about lots of things that we don't have any control over, especially in the normative domain. So I might think stealing is wrong, no one should steal. I might have no idea how to make it the case that no one should steal. Nonetheless, these kind of debates in moral philosophy might be interesting, might be worth having. And so likewise, we might think, well, we ought to mean such and such. How do we make it the case that we mean such and such? No clue. Nonetheless, it might be interesting, worth engaging in this kind of normative theorizing. Okay, well, I think that's kind of a good point. If it's a fact that we don't have control over meaning, that might not be a decisive obstacle to some construals of what conceptual engineering should amount to. But that is not what's at issue here. For one thing, we do have at least some kind of control over what theories we accept. There are, of course, issues about doxastic voluntarism and the like in the vicinity here. But it looks like we have as much control. This is a theory that gives us as much control as we might reasonably expect. So the problem isn't control. It's not externalism either, because this is really a pretty internalist friendly theory. We haven't really said enough so far because we were only defining the theoretical terms and taking for granted the meaning of the already established vocabulary. We haven't really said enough to decide whether, as presented, it's an externalist theory. But nonetheless, it doesn't look like externalism is the problem. But I want to suggest that there are two relevant features of this view that together are going to generate the problem. The kind of obvious one is that meaning is determined by theory. So what the Ramsey-Carnap-Lewis view is saying is that to use a theoretical term with a particular meaning just is to accept a certain theory. So there can be no difference in meaning, for theoretical terms at least, without a difference in theory. And you can see that once you've got this kind of commitment in the picture, there's not going to be much for you to do but theorize. It's going to be hard to find this kind of additional thing that the conceptual engineer wants there to be. That it looks like there's just going to be theorizing, and you accept a theory and meaning comes along in its train. Okay, I think that's kind of more or less right. And in a way, that's the crucial point that I want to make. But I think there's something more to it, because you might think that it's at least conceivable. This is the kind of possibility that Cappelen entertains, actually. That theory might determine meaning in a really problematic way. So determination of meaning just says, you get the theory, it's kind of supervenience claim. You get the theory, you'll get a meaning along with it. But maybe the metaphysics of meaning is such that if you accept theory one, you get some kind of really bizarre meanings, like accepting theory one makes it the case that the force is correctly applied to all and only red things. And so if you accept theory one, you end up with these kind of really weird false beliefs and so on. That's compatible with determination of meaning by theory, because again, determination of meaning by theory just says accepting the theory determines the meaning, but it might, for all this says, determine it in a really weird way. Now, if we had reason to think we were in this kind of situation, we might want to change our theory, and we might want to change other things, and we might need to attend to other factors that evidence and familiar kinds of pragmatic factors and so on in order to do that. So if we were in this kind of situation where there was a really weird metasemantics in play, there would be something else for us to do to set up our theory in such a way that we got meanings that weren't weird, inappropriate ones. Now, Ramsey-Carnap-Lewis doesn't have this problem. The meanings that it will deliver fit the theory. It's a little bit hard to say exactly what fit amounts to here, but I think at least what RCL will give you is, in cases where we kind of intuitively thought that the theory was true, the theory will come out true, and the theoretical terms will pick out the kind of things that we would have pre-theoretically taken them to pick out. So I want to say, as long as a view supports a metasemantics that is supports this further constraint of appropriateness, in addition to the determination of meaning by theory, there'll be no room for conceptual engineering. So appropriateness, meaning is determined in a way appropriate to the theory. Again, it's pretty tricky to say in a theory neutral kind of way exactly what appropriateness amounts to, but I hope the examples that I've given give you an idea. And I'll say a bit more about what appropriateness is going to amount to on my view, if there's time at the end. Okay, so with these ingredients in place, I think we have the materials for an argument against the possibility of conceptual engineering. So premise one says, suppose meaning is determined by theory, and suppose one is dissatisfied with some aspect of one's vocabulary or conceptual apparatus. So we're in the kind of situation that Cappelen's describing in this master argument, where we have reason to think that the meanings we've got aren't the best possible ones. So then I think there are two possibilities. Either our dissatisfaction is due to a problem with the theory, for example, the theory's false, or not well supported by evidence, or racist, or et cetera, et cetera. Or it's due to inappropriateness. Although there's nothing wrong with the theory, the words in it have meanings that are inappropriate. But if appropriateness is true, then two is impossible. And if, so that leaves us with the one, that's the only other option. And if one is true, then the right response is to modify or replace the theory. But when we're doing that, we're going to be engaging in these familiar kinds of theorizing activities, assessing evidence, looking for new evidence, and so on. And by distinctness, this isn't conceptual engineering. So what I think this shows is, on the assumption that meaning is determined by theory, and it's determined by theory in an appropriate way, then the only thing that there is for us to do is theorize. There's no further activity of conceptual engineering. So to go back to the master argument as reconstructed by me with distinctiveness built into premise three. So premise three says, when we speak, think, and theorize, there is an additional activity over and above theorizing that it's important to engage in. We have to make sure our words have as good meanings as possible. What I think this argument shows is that given the determination of meaning by theory and given appropriateness, that premise is false. And so the master argument, so understood, is going to fail on the supposition that that kind of metasemantic theory is true. Okay, so this more or less concludes my basic conditional case against the possibility of conceptual engineering. It's conditional because, again, it's conditional on there being a true metasemantic theory that supports the determination of meaning by theory and appropriateness. But I want to consider now a possible kind of objection that draws on another line of argument that is prominent in Cappelen's work, and I think in some other relevant work on this topic too. So what about the people who either describe themselves as conceptual engineers or describe themselves in ways that suggest what they're doing is evaluating terminology and replacing it and things like that? Doesn't that show, doesn't that show that conceptual engineering is possible because they say they're doing it, right? Okay, well, I mean, as a preliminary point, the fact that they say they're doing it doesn't entail that they are doing it or even that it is a possible thing to do. After all, people spent a lot of time trying to square the circle and things like that, and you can prove that that can't be done. So I think this is kind of weak evidence. It's possible that these people aren't doing what they think they're doing. On the other hand, there's some motivation to take their self-descriptions at face value. So I want to kind of do that and look carefully at just one case of somebody who Cappelen takes to be engaged in a kind of conceptual engineering activity. And I'm going to argue that, in fact, what they're doing is compatible with and indeed suggestive of the kind of argument that I've just given. So, and for what it's worth, I think this case is going to, or what I'm about to say, will generalize to the other kinds of cases he discusses too. So this is the first case that Cappelen mentions in Fixing Language. It's Andy Clark and David Chalmers on the extended mind. And so this is a passage that Cappelen quotes. "We do not intend to debate what is standard usage. Our broader point is that the notion of belief ought to be used so that Otto qualifies as having the belief in question. In all important respects, Otto's case is similar to a standard case of non-occurrent belief. By using the belief notion in a wider way, it picks out something more akin to a natural kind. The notion becomes deeper and more unified and is more useful in explanation." Okay. So you can see why Hermann thought that this is supportive of a kind of conceptual engineering thing, because they're saying, well, maybe it's true that belief as we use it now has a certain meaning. Nonetheless, it would be better if it had a different meaning. And so we should try to make it the case that it does have that better meaning. Thought of in that way, you can see why this looks like a kind of case of conceptual engineering. But I think it's important to consider the dialectic here. So the primary thing that Clark and Chalmers are trying to do here is to defend a certain view, a certain theory, namely the extended mind theory. This passage comes as they're addressing a kind of objection to their theory. The objection is, or one way to put the objection would be something like, well, maybe your theory has a lot going for it, but nonetheless, the meaning of belief is inappropriate to that theory. The meaning of belief is such as to make it impossible to apply the word belief to information that you have access to only via external devices. So I think the objection that they're responding to here relies on the denial of appropriateness. It's in effect, if you go back to the argument here, it's saying, maybe there's nothing wrong with your theory, but you're using a word that has a meaning that's inappropriate to the theory. If appropriateness is true, this kind of objection just won't get off the ground. And so having to respond to it in the kind of way they do won't make any sense. I think the same is true of most of the other kinds of cases of philosophers who want to talk this way that Cappelen discusses. So if you think of somebody like Peter Railton, I think he is again assuming that we have this certain normative kinds of language that has particular meanings, those meanings are going to be inappropriate to the true theory. What he's most interested in is defending this kind of theory, and then we might have to, as he thinks of it, change the language in order to make it appropriate to this kind of theory. I think if appropriateness is true, that kind of project won't look very compelling. Okay. So here's the conclusion that I have tried to defend so far. If any metasemantic view on which meaning is determined by theory in an appropriate way is true, then conceptual engineering is impossible. Now, I haven't tried to convince you of the antecedent of that claim. I've presented you a kind of example, the Ramsey Carnap Lewis view, but I myself don't endorse that view, and I don't think you should endorse it either. So what I want to go on to do is to tell you a little bit about the view that I would endorse and to discuss why I think it's going to support the kind of argument that I've been giving. Before I do that, can how much time do I have? What I can't see. How long have I been going?
So you still have about 15 minutes.
Okay, great. Okay, so I think that the problem with the Ramsey Carnap Lewis view is that we shouldn't say that meaning is determined by our theories, by our beliefs and the sentences we accept and so on at a particular time. So that is to say, what we mean now is determined by our theory now. What we mean tomorrow is determined by our theory tomorrow, and so on. This is almost certainly going to result in too much meaning change. And I think that that's problematic because it fails to vindicate our retrospective reports and evaluations. So it will fail to vindicate things like, suppose that I used to, last week, I accepted theory one, and now I accept theory two. I want to say things like, I used to think that the force was all pervasive, but now I see that was a mistake, I was wrong. Given a view like RCL, it's going to be very hard to vindicate that kind of report. It's hard to see how it could be true that speaking as I do now, I used to think that the force was all pervasive, because what I mean now by the force isn't what I meant then. So what I said or what I thought then isn't well captured by what I say now when I say the force is all pervasive. And on many versions of the view, it's hard to see how what I said then was wrong. Perhaps in this particular case, to the extent that presupposes the existence of this all pervasive thing, it will come out false, but I could have made the report something like, I used to think that if the force exists, it's all pervasive, but now I see that was wrong. And RCL will predict that on theory one, that conditional is true. So what I used to think should be true, not wrong. Okay. I think these kind of retrospective reports and evaluations are super important when we're theorizing over time. So often what we're doing in the course of a debate, or even as we're trying to come to some conclusion ourselves, we are thinking hard about different kinds of evidence. We have one view and then we reject it for a particular reason at a particular time. And we'll look back on that dialectic and think about what was right and wrong and what we thought before, what that evidence really tells against. If these kind of retrospective reports and evaluations fall apart, that important part of our theorizing is just going to be a mess. And that's a disastrous consequence in my view. We need a view that allows for more meaning constancy over time. So here's the kind of view that I would want to endorse. If I'm trying to decide between theory one and theory two, or more generally, I'm investigating the force and I'm trying to find out about its features, what I mean by the force now, at the beginning of my investigation, is determined not by the theory I accept now, but by the theory I accept at the end of my investigation. So if now I accept theory two, and I later come to think theory two is wrong, some other theory is right, it's that other theory that determines what I mean now. And that's going to explain why I think theory two was wrong. Likewise, if we're in a kind of debate, you're a proponent of theory one, I'm a proponent of theory two, and you convince me. I'm going to look back and think, well, I used to think that the force was merely widespread, but now I see really it's all pervasive. I'm going to look back on my previous acceptance of theory two and think that I was making a mistake. And the best way of making sense of that, I submit, is that what I think later plays a role in determining what I mean now. Okay. So that's to say, this view is an instance of temporal externalism, and that's the view that intentional properties, such as the contents of my thoughts and the meanings of my words at a particular time t, are determined at least in part by facts after t. Now, I don't have time to go into all the details of the kind of view that I would want to defend here, but I would like to say a little bit about how this kind of view fares with respect to appropriateness and the kind of anti-conceptual engineering argument that I was giving earlier. There's a sense in which temporal externalism isn't going to vindicate appropriateness. But I think in that sense, no one should want to vindicate appropriateness. So consider if we're engaged in a debate, in a dispute, where we disagree about some theoretical matter that looks like a matter of definition, neither of us will think we should be looking for a metasemantics that makes all of our claims true. So appropriateness doesn't just mean we're looking for meanings for our words that make our theories true. That's just because in this kind of situation, I don't think your view is true. I think my view is true and you're wrong. Setting aside cases in which we agree that our dispute is kind of verbal or metalinguistic in some way. I think those kind of cases are, they do happen for sure, but those are a minority. And likewise, if you convince me, or in the case where I'm theorizing alone and I change my view, when I look back at our entire discussion, the entire course of our inquiry, I won't think that we should assign meanings in such a way that makes all of our previous claims true. I'll think, well, when I accepted theory one and I said the force is all pervasive, I was wrong about that. Really, the force isn't all pervasive. That was false. So I think everyone should accept that in looking for a metasemantics that's appropriate to an entire course of discussion, an entire debate, we sometimes need to assign meanings that are inappropriate to some views that are held at some times during the course of that debate or that inquiry. In effect, that's just to say some theories are false. Now, so that's why I say in a there are some ways of understanding appropriateness on which temporal externalism of the kind I favor isn't going to deliver appropriateness. If I come to accept theory two, now I accept theory one, what I mean now is in a sense inappropriate to my theory, not as radically as the red example I gave earlier, but nonetheless, in a sense inappropriate to my theory. But I think it's that temporal externalism is still going to deliver something that's going to vindicate the kind of anti-conceptual engineering argument that I described. Given my version of temporal externalism, there's nothing to do but theorize. So if we go back to the argument, suppose that I'm worried about some aspect of my vocabulary or my conceptual apparatus. Now, either this dissatisfaction is due to a problem with the theory, or although there's nothing wrong with the theory, the words in it have meanings that are inappropriate. Well, there may be a kind of situation in which two could occur in given temporal externalism. That is a situation in which I now have a good theory and I'm later going to come to accept a bad theory. That's an interesting kind of case, which is something that we could discuss. But even in that kind of case, there's really nothing for me to do in terms of trying to make myself mean something, or trying to figure out whether there really is a problem with what I mean, et cetera, et cetera. There's nothing to do except working out the theory. If I think that some other theory would give me a better meaning, I should defend that theory. That's the thing to do. There's just no further activity other than assessing the evidence, defending the theory in the familiar kinds of ways. And so by delivering a kind of meaning that is appropriate to the whole course of a discussion, we're going to deliver something that's going to vindicate this kind of argument. Okay. So just very briefly, I want to mention some kinds of theoretical choice points here that might give you some wiggle room. So it's certainly not the case that temporal externalism as such is going to deliver either this kind of determination of meaning by theory or this kind of appropriateness that's going to drive this kind of argument. Although I have to say, I think that the by far the most plausible versions of it will deliver that. And even in the cases where it does deliver something like this, there may be a little bit of wiggle room. So that's what I'm going to discuss briefly now. So temporal externalism as such just in effect says later things can bear on what I mean now. Now, two things about that claim. First of all, that claim as such doesn't say what later things matter. I've introduced another kind of commitment, which is that it is our kind of judgments, our theory at the end of inquiry, that's the later thing that matters. You could defend other versions of temporal externalism on which it was the physical environment later or something like that that does some of the work. And on those kind of views, there's much more possibility of inappropriateness. Those kind of views have little or nothing to say in their favor, as far as I can tell, but there is that option. But even for the kind of view that I want to defend, I don't think this is a complete metasemantic theory. I think that Putnam-style model theoretic arguments and other kinds of arguments refute the idea that this can be the only kind of fact that plays a role in fixing what we mean. We have to get some other kinds of environmental friction in there somehow. And I don't have much to say about exactly how that's going to work, but in principle, this could make for violations of appropriateness. And I think where there are violations of appropriateness, there might be room for some kind of distinct activity of conceptual engineering. Okay. Secondly, in presenting the Lewis Ramsey Carnap view, and then in defending this kind of view myself, I've assumed that there's a distinction between those things that are kind of part of the theory that does the meaning fixing work and those things that are mere incidental beliefs. So we might think that some particular person, Luke Skywalker, is strong in the Force. Most people wouldn't think that that belongs in the definition of the expression, the Force. Even proponents of Ramsey Carnap Lewis kind of view might want to exclude that from the definition. That's just to say that this kind of view, as I presented it, is committed to a kind of analytic synthetic distinction. So some of our claims, some parts of our overall picture, our overall set of beliefs and acceptances about how the world is, are going to play a meaning-fixing role, and others aren't. I think that's right. I love me some Quine, but in this case, I think that Grice and Strawson made the right point. We're all pretty sensitive to the distinction between those kinds of claims that look like matters of definition and those that don't. It looks like there's a distinction that we're tracking there, and we have every reason to take that theoretically seriously. Okay, so suppose that's right. Now here's a question. Can we change what's analytic? So if we are Ramsey, Carnap, Lewis, we're accepting a particular theory and that's determining what we mean. We can't change what we mean without changing the theory, but there might be a way of thinking of changing the theory that doesn't just involve the kind of theorizing that I said everyone agrees that there is. Namely, we might try to get more or fewer things into that part of the theory that does the meaning determining. So maybe I think we'd be better off if we took it to be analytic that Luke Skywalker is strong in the Force. Maybe then I could work to incorporate that into the theory that by the lights of Ramsey, Carnap, and Lewis does the meaning fixing. I think if that possibility makes sense, it's not clear to me that it does, but it's also not clear to me that it doesn't. If that makes sense, that would be a kind of distinctive conceptual engineering activity. Likewise, on temporal externalism, I say, meaning is fixed by our judgments at the end of a line of inquiry. Which judgments? Well, I'm kind of taking it for granted that we know which ones are analytic and which aren't. But maybe that's not so, and maybe we can work to make it the case that some are and some aren't. If so, again, I think that would be something kind of worth calling a distinctive kind of conceptual engineering. One further kind of idea, I'm relying on the idea that there is less meaning change across time than someone like Ramsey, Carnap, and Lewis would have thought. So Lewis is kind of suggesting, he does consider some ways of mitigating this, but the most straightforward version of this kind of view is going to predict that changes in theory amount to changes in meaning. And I want to say, no, that's not right. In fact, we can think of our meaning as a kind of long tradition, that the meanings as implicated in this long tradition of inquiry where we can look back on what we said before and say, oh, I used to say that such and such, and that was not true, and that was true, and that was supported by that evidence, and so on. But one thing that we might try to do is to shape that tradition. So we might think about how far our tradition extends. Where was there a meaning change? And perhaps we can even do some work in shaping how far that tradition is going to extend into the future in cases that we might be worried. We might think we have the right theory now and we don't want to be shaken out of it later. We might take steps to, we don't want what we do later to shape what we mean now. We might take steps to try and prevent that from happening. Again, it's not clear to me that this is really possible, but if it is, I think that would be a distinctive thing for the conceptual engineer to do, a kind of distinctive conceptual engineering activity. Oh. Okay. So let me just try and sum up really briefly here. I've defended the claim that given a certain familiar kind of metasemantic view, there's no room for a distinctive activity of conceptual engineering. I've suggested that that familiar view has its difficulties, but There's a related, attractive view, the view that I myself would want to defend, this kind of temporal externalism, which relies on our judgments at the end of a line of inquiry to fix meaning, that's going to deliver the same result. Given that that's true, I think that conceptual engineers should rethink what they're doing. If they're sympathetic to these kind of metasemantic stories, they should rethink their conceptual engineering project. But if they're not, they should rethink what the threats to that project are. Again, it seems like there's some significant discussion of the relation between conceptual engineering and externalism, and control, and things like that. But I don't think those are the real threats. I think the real threat is the kind of view that I would want to push, where we're all trying to arrive at the right theory. We can engage in various kinds of theoretical activities to do that. Some might involve the kind of normative and revisionary theorizing that many conceptual engineers have, many self-described conceptual engineers have drawn our attention to. But those shouldn't be thought of as some kind of distinctive activity over and above the familiar kinds of evidence gathering and evaluation of theories that everyone always agreed that there was. There just isn't anything more than that to do. And I think that's it. Thanks.